Recording.
OK. So last time, we finished by providing example of rigid monoidal category. And we will start today by providing a last example of rigid monoidal category. So example three of rigid monoidal category. So let M be a monoid, just an algebraic monoid. Then the category of vector space graded by the monoid M is a rigid monoidal category. So it's a monoidal category, but it's rigid if and only if M is a group. In fact, rigid is a categorical analogous of inverse. And in fact, a monoid with inverse is a group. So it's not surprising. So if, as I said, rigid means the existence of left dual. And here, for vec M, we have the simple object, and the left dual can be taken to be the right dual, just the simple object corresponding to the inverse of the element G. The evaluation and co-evaluation map corresponding to this left dual is just like that. So it's a fact is trivial. Co-ev delta g inverse delta one, because this is equal to delta one itself. So these two maps are in fact just the identity of, this is just the identity. Anyway, so it's quite a trivial example. But it's good to have in mind that rigid corresponds to existence of inverse, dual corresponds to inverse. Okay, so a monoidal category is a categorification of the notion of monoid. A rigid monoidal category is a categorification of the notion of group. So vec So this monoidal category is also rigid. So if you consider, now M should be a group, and you can deform by omega the associativity, is also rigid with above evaluation and co-evaluation map. Up to renormalizing omega. So maybe you need to renormalize it. That means you need to modify it by some constant. Anyway, okay. Next remark will be about the dual versus the opposite category. And rigidity. So there is a notion of dual category, notion of opposite category, and we will see that for monoidal category, when it is rigid, then these two notions are more or less equivalent. We will see in what sense. Rigidity. So let C be a monoidal category with left dual. That means every object has a left dual. So I don't say it's not a rigid monoidal category because I don't say that every object has a left and a right dual. It's just a left rigid, if you prefer. So the duality. The duality like that or like and like that defined last week is a fully faithful. So we already defined what's the meaning of that. Contravariant functor. Contravariant functor. So it's not a functor in the sense that we defined before. It's a contravariant functor, which means error reversing. It's a functor which reverses, so it's not a functor. So it's like a functor, but it reverses the error. And should be opposed to the notion of covariant. As we defined a functor before as a covariant functor. But in fact, you have two notions of functor, covariant, contravariant. One reverse the arrow and the other keep the orientation of the arrow. So okay. So the duality, this duality induce a contravariant functor. So if you want to make something covariant, in fact, you need to consider dual category and opposite category. In fact, it induce a monoidal functor, and we don't precise it. This means a covariant between this category and this category. And the first is called the dual category, which means the arrow reversed. And this one is the opposite category. And here it's the operation is the tensor product, which is reversed. In fact, we see last time that the dual operation induces a reverse of the arrow, but also a reverse of the tensor product. X tensor Y star is Y star tensor X star. Okay, so then co va. So if you apply the duality two times, you get a covariant. So contravariant, if you reverse two times the arrow, you get you keep the you come back to the original orientation. So the covariant functor so like that, if you apply two times dual, is monoidal. Because of that. Moreover, in a rigid monoidal category. So si like that CV and C up are monoidally equivalent. Monoidally equivalent. So is also monoidal auto-equivalence from C to itself. From C to itself. With quasi-inverse. So the notion of quasi-inverse is a notion used to define monoidal equivalence. So with quasi inverse, this one, when you apply two times the right dual. But be careful, but be careful, X star. The left dual and the right dual of X could be non-isomorphic. Isomorphic in general. Okay. So anyway, this does not matter too much. In fact, this it's, we are in the chapter of rigid monoidal category. We define left dual. We see that the dual inverse the error, inverse the tensor product. So we can state that we can. Yeah. This functor with a double star like that will be used in the once we will finish the summary part, we will introduce the notion of pivotal monoidal category, and then this functor will play a role, important role for pivotal monoidal category. Okay, so the last proposition about rigid monoidal category. And then we will recall the notion of tensor category. So position. So this proposition say that in a monoidal category, if you have a natural transformation between two monoidal functors, then it must be a natural isomorphism. In the rigid case, and it's false in the non-rigid case. So there is a kind of rigidity. That's why maybe that is called a rigid. So if you take two rigid monoidal category, you take two functor, monoidal functor from C to D. Monoidal functor. Then a natural transformation of monoidal functor, so like that. Must be a natural isomorphism. Must be. And it's false in the non-rigid case in general. So the rigid assumption imply some rigidity on the natural transformation. Natural transformation must be a natural isomorphism. Okay. So so that's okay for rigid monoidal category. So let's recall now all the definition about tensor category. So that was the end of chapter 2 of the book. So the chapter about monoidal category. Now we will let us now cover chapter 4 according to the recommendation in introduction of the book. So in the book there recommend to start by chapter 2. We did not do chapter 1. Chapter 1 about abelian category. We start, chapter 1 is about abelian category. Yeah. We did directly chapter 2 and then they asked to do directly. It's at the end of, not the introduction, but the preface. Preface. Yeah, in the preface of the book, there is some recommendation for a teaching of this book, and we'll go from chapter 2 and then chapter 4. We skip chapter 1 and 3, and we can come back to some part of chapter 1 and chapter 3, we need, so piece by piece. Okay, so now chapter 4, tensor category. Tensor categories. So so let K be filled. So the problem with this chapter, in fact, with the beginning of the chapter, we need to cover the beginning of the chapter, and this is more or less only definition. So we will need to recall a lot of definitions. So I cannot summarize too much this part, because there is a lot of definition, and then I will need to recall a definition from some consequence of Frobenius-Perron theorem. And mainly, I will have to recall a lot of definition about abelian category. And this is only definition, so I cannot summarize it. So from now, up to the end of this session, this will be more or less exactly as what I did last semester for this session, because I have to state all the definition. So I'm sorry for people who attended this last semester, but anyway, it's still good to recall the basis, even for me. So, definition. So we will first state the definition of multi-tensor category, tensor category, multi-fusion category, fusion category. So we will state the definition of that. And in this definition, you will have a new notion. I did not introduce yet. So most of this new notion will be introduced in the abelian category part. I will do just after that. So you will have some word like that. This word will be defined just after. So don't worry. We'll provide a definition. And in this definition, we'll have a lot of new words. And this new word will be defined very soon in the section about abelian category. And then I will restate again the definition of tensor category with all the notion we defined. And you will see that this is not so complicated, I hope. In fact, we already, I will start by making a dictionary between with a fusion category and fusion ring, and you see in what sense the new notion of categorification of something known. Okay, so let's go. So multi-tensor category. Si. Multi-tensor category C is a locally finite. So first word, locally finite. We will define very soon. K linear. What else? Abelian. Rigid, we already know. Monoidal category, we already know. Such that, what time is it? Okay. The B functor, like that. Is B linear on the morphism? So B linear in the sense of here you have something K linear. So this B functor should be B linear on the morphism. Okay. Next, such C. Moreover, such C is called indecomposable. So again, we will define that soon, very soon. If it is not equivalent to a direct sum. Direct sum. Of non-zero multi-tensor category. Categories. If in addition, the set of endomorphism from one to itself, the space, because it's K-linear, is equivalent to the one-dimensional K-vector space, then C is called. So if in addition to indecomposable and all what I said before, then C is called a tensor product, a tensor category. And finally, what we are really interested in, at least now, fusion category. So a multi fusion category. What is that? So is a finite. We will define semi-simple. We will define multi-tensor category. That's big, but you will see everything is natural. And then in the semi-simple case, then this condition, by Shor's lemma, we will state soon, is equivalent to the unit element to be a simple object. Okay, so how to make this notion intuitive before making this notion precise? How to make it intuitive? Before making all this new notion precisely defined, let us make them intuitive through a dictionary with Fusion Ring. So, a fusion category is a categorification of the notion of fusion ring. So the definition of a fusion category is a categorification also of the definition of a fusion ring. So let's a fusion ring. So a fusion ring here, and then there's a categorification. And the notion of fusion category. Here. So we will restate all the definition. We restate the definition of fusion ring, and point by point, we will write the categorical analogous of that. So first point of fusion ring, you have finite basis B equal B1 up to BR. This corresponds to So this corresponds to something here. So how to write that? Directly. So this corresponds to I will draw something like that. Finitely many simple objects. Up to isomorphism. So this is here finite. So this corresponds to finite. Okay, next, you have the fusion rule. Fusion rules. Bi, bj equal to the sum for k equal 1 to r, nij, k, bk. And this corresponds to semi-simple. These correspond to simple object and the tensor product. Monoideal, where is monoideal? Yeah. The tensor product, the product corresponds to the tensor product. And it's semi-simple, it decomposes into a simple object. So it's semi-simple, corresponds to semi-simple, and also corresponds to monoideal, but I will write that later. For the product. Next. With, so you have nijk should be non-negative integer. And this corresponds to finite dimension of the Ohm space. So it's again one of the finiteness. Next. In fact, you have nijk, which is equal to the dimension over the field k of the Ohm C. So let me write that here. Nijk equal dimension of k of Ohm C xi tensor xj xk. So finite dimensional. Next, associativity. Bi, bj, bk equal bi, bj, bk. And this corresponds to to what? The Pentagon axiom, and you're the neutral B1 BI equal BI B1 equal BI, and this corresponds to the unit axiom, and also the fact. This assumption Ohm C. In the fusion, the assumption and one simple. So let me write, should be more. And on C, one equal K. this means that one is a simple object. So you have B1, the neutral, which is among which is in this finite basis. Okay, so. Yeah. One simple. Okay, and finally, you have the dual for all I. There exists a unique I star with n I k one equal n k I one. Equal delta I star k. And this corresponds to so you should write, maybe you can write too rigid. Rigid. So here you can also add plus monoidal. And this one and this one, so monoidal. It's not very clean. No. Dal. Okay. And the last assumption, Frobenius reciprocity, NIJK equal N I star K G equal N G star K I. In other words, as I said, fusion matrix of dual object equal adjoint matrix. That should be in green. That corresponds to K-linear. Linear. Okay. Okay, so you can have more or less intuition of this new notion, at least for fusion category, using the purely combinatorial algebraic notion, easy for fusion ring. So just a categorification of that. Okay, so what time is it? So it's time for the pause.
Recording.
Okay. So, so we can associate a fusion ring. We can associate a fusion ring to a fusion category. It's called its Grothendieck ring. We will define it in detail later. But it's not always possible to go to categorify a fusion ring. There are some fusion rings which are not Grothendieck ring of a fusion category. And the obstruction for a fusion ring to be a Grothendieck ring is the Pentagon equation, Pentagon axiom, restated as an equation. So we can associate a fusion ring to a fusion category called its Grothendieck ring So we will see it later. But not all fusion ring are Grothendieck ring, which means that are come from a category. Not all are catégorifiables. Obstruction equal pentagon equation. The obstruction is a pentagon equation. The pentagon equation induced by pentagon axiom. So there is something deeper in the right column, in particular about associativity here. Here on the left, the associativity of a fusion ring is more or less a trivial associativity, where the associativity constraint corresponds to trivial, is trivial. But in general, a fusion category, so it's more or less like it, what we called, not skeletal, but the other one. I forgot. So a fusion category where every associativity constraint is trivial, but in general, it's not trivial. It cannot be both a skeletal and this corresponds to what I said last time. Strict. Yeah. The fusion category in general cannot be both, or a monoidal category cannot be both strict and skeletal. And this is why you have such obstruction. That is why. Okay. So the classification of fusion ring, nevertheless, the classification of fusion category up to equivalence. And here we can consider the skeletal. We can reduce to skeletal category every monoidal category is equivalent to a skeletal one. So up to equivalence reduce to the classification of fusion ring and solution of pentagon equation. To the classification of the fusion rings and this is hard part, there solution to the pentagon equation system of polynomial equation. Of degree 3. So the last point about the Pentagon equation. Is very hard. Very hard. Because the Pentagon equation is a huge, and I will write also like that, because it's really huge. The huge over determinated, which means there are more equations than variables, system. When I say it's huge, it's really huge. So you can have you can usually meet, I don't know, a system of degree 3. You can have 1 million equations and 100,000 variables. So and this is for some small example of fusion ring of rank 7 or something like that. So a direct approach is very hard and almost impossible. Okay. But in theory, the classification of fusion category reduces the classification of fusion ring and the solution of Pentagon equation. Even it is very hard, this is true. So usually people try to avoid the use of Pentagon equation. And in my own research, recent research, we try to use the Pentagon equation to categorify some new type of fusion ring and category, to find new type of fusion category. Okay, so that was the end of last semester session 13. So let's start the summary of last semester session 14. And this semester, this session will be not really summarized. This will be more or less exactly the same thing that last semester session 14. It's very hard to summarize because this is a recall about Frobenius-Perron dimension consequences about fusion category and Frobenius-Perron dimension and recall on abelian category. So before defining all the new notion mentioned above, so what I called the word like that, let us define the notion of Frobenius-Perron dimension. So I put that here because this is a notion which exist at the level of fusion ring. So we don't, because we just recall the fusion ring, it's good to put that here, but we will need this later. So let F be a fusion ring. Be a fusion ring with basis B equal B1 up to BR, with B1 the unit so the dual induce so from the dual you can define a finite dimensional star algebra on the algebra generated by this basis over the complex field. So the dual induce a structure of finite dimensional star algebra on algebra generated by B over the complex field. And so it's not really the Frobenius-Perron theorem what I will state now, but it's a corollary. That's why I write by the Frobenius-Perron theorem. There exists. So from there exists a notion of dimension on this algebra CB. There exists a unique star homomorphism. So star homomorphism, which means it's a map which which keep the algebra structure and the star algebra structure such that the image of the basis is included in this open interval. This is an open interval. It's not a couple. It's an open interval. So it's strictly greater than zero, but finite. I wrote this is the image of the basis, not the image of that. The image of that can be negative, in fact, can be complex. The image of the basis is really, this corresponds to the notion of dimension. It is a notion of dimension, not necessarily integral, not always integral, non-integral dimension, not always integral. So you can have something of dimension 1 plus square root of 5 over 2. You will see an example of that. some notation. The Frobenius-Perron dimension of BI in B is so denoted like that FP dim BI just image of BI by this map. this unique map. Unicity comes from the Frobenius-Perron theorem. And for simplicity, we will denote it just di. So this is the Frobenius-Perron dimension of one object of the basis. And you have the Frobenius-Perron dimension of the full fusion ring. And this corresponds also to fusion category via the Grothendieck ring. You have the Frobenius-Perron dimension of the fusion category. So you take the sum of the square of the dimension of the simple, of the basic elements. As for finite group and representation ring of finite group, the sum of the irreducible representation of the complex over the complex field. And here you have R, the cardinal of B is called the rank of F. And the type of the fusion is this list of Frobenius-Perron dimensions, the full list, order list. It's an ordered list. Ordered list. Okay. Next. The fusion ring. So two ways to qualify the fusion ring is called. So of Frobenius type if for all I, the quotient of the global dimension of the fusion ring, Frobenius-Perron dimension divided by the Frobenius-Perron dimension of any basic element should be an algebraic integer. So if this is true for all I, then the fusion ring or the fusion category with this Grothendieck ring is called of Frobenius type. And there are some conjecture about the fact that every fusion category are of Frobenius type, but not every fusion ring are of Frobenius type. So it is called integral if for all I, di is a positive integer. So here I wrote di, this is the same, di, fpdim of bi. So a positive integer. It can be non-integer. So let's see an example where it is non-integer, but if it is integer, then it's called integral. So example. The smallest smallest non-integral example example, the golden fusion beam. With the Yang-Li rule. So golden. So you have, so what is this example? So the basis, you have two elements, so it's rank two. You only need to know the rule for B2 because B1 is a neutral. And it's like that. So this completely defines the fusion ring. So it is of type 1 phi, the type here, the least order list of Frobenius per dimension, where phi is the golden ratio. So it's non an integer because B, so you apply the map D to B. So because it's an homomorphism, we know that this is B to square, but we also know that it's 1 plus D2 because D is an homomorphism. Then D2 must be, because it's positive, it must be the golden ratio, 1 plus square root of 5 over 2. And we know it admits a categorification. So there is a fusion category in which you have a notion of dimension which is non-integral. This is the smallest example. Okay. So that's all for what I wanted to recall about Frobenius per dimension. So it's a generalization of the notion of dimension of vector space. I don't know. But here, you can have non-integral dimension. It's finite, but non-integral. So it's interesting. It may be related to maybe to fractal Hausdorff dimension. Maybe could be good to have a result about fractal and Frobenius per dimension. So now, we will make some recall. This part will be recall about abelian categories theory. In fact, most of the notion, the new notion, the definition of multi-tensor category, etc., come from abelian category theory. So we need to, yeah, I will not. Basic notion from recall about, yeah, basic notion. Basic notion. And this corresponds to this corresponds to the chapter one of the book. So we will not cover all the chapter one here. But some of them. Later in the course, we will sometime recall some basic notion of abelian category from chapter one. So here we will call only what we need. So definition. So we will recall here only what we need. Okay, so definition. An additive to what we need for chapter four. For the beginning of chapter four. And we will come back to chapter one later also. Okay. So what is an additive category? An additive category, before defining what is an abelian category, we need the notion of additive category, which is weaker. An additive category is a locally small, which means the morphism between two objects form a set. The locally small category, si satisfying the following axioms. So, first axiom. So we will cover this part about abelian category today and the next session, and that should be enough. So recall that the next session, it will be Saturday because of holiday. Next Monday is holiday, so the next session will be on Saturday. As I already mentioned in the WeChat group. So satisfying the following axiom. So what is the first axiom? So you have abelian group structure on the Ohm set. Every set Ohm C X Y as a structure of abelian group. And this structure is noted with a plus, such that the composition of morphism is B additive, which means only the following. So the composition deal correctly with the addition. Or on the left and the right. Easy. Plus FH. Okay. Second axiom. A1, A2. So the second axiom says that there is a zero object, which plays the role of the zero in an abelian category, in an abelian group. So there exists a zero object. Such that the home set between zero and itself reduced to it's a single. So it's written zero, which is just a single morphism between so identity which is zero and itself. So and the last axiom. Is about the direct sum existence of direct sum for all x1, x2 in C. There is a way to define the generalization of the notion of the direct sum. So we will need, this will be defined by diagram and as a universal property. So for all x1, x2, there is y in C. And it's not a universal property here. The universal property will be for some other notion later. So, and the following morphism. So you have another object y which will be the direct sum. Then other morphism and the following morphism. Morphism. So you have y, you have x1, x2, and you have this morphism. So you have one morphism between y and x1 called P1, and one between y and x2, P2, and one on the other way, I1, I2. So P plays the role of projection in some sense, and I plays the role of injection, embedding. So such that you have this morphism, such that P K I K is the identity of X K. K equal 1, 2, and you have I1 composed with P1 plus I2 composed with P2 is identity of Y. So this is exactly what should happen. This is exactly what happened for a vector space with direct product. You have projection and embedding, and this satisfies this equality. But here, the category is not a category of vector space. So it's something more This is something abstract. Okay. And remark. It's not a remark. Such, this is in the definition. Such Y is unique. Up to a unique isomorphism. It is denoted direct sum of x1 and x2 and is called direct sum of x1 and x2. Okay. Okay. So in additive category, you have, as for a monoidal category, you have a bifunctor, additive bifunctor. For monoidal category, it's a multiplicative bifunctor. Then such C is equipped with the bifunctor C cross C to C. X plus Y. Okay. Next. So this will be a list of definition. So maybe it will be a bit boring, but no choice. Let K. So now we will define what is meaning of K linear. Let K be a field so an additive category C is K-linear. K-linear. One first notion we wanted to know, define, if the abelian group om C X Y is in fact a K vector space. Such that the composition of morphism as before, but with the K-linearity, composition of morphism is K-linear. K-linear. Which means K-linear, which means A1, all that. So which mean A1 and for the addition and for the scalar, lambda F composed with nu G is lambda mu, the F composed with G. For all lambda mu in the field and for all FG morphism. Okay. So definition. So you take two K linear additive category. They can be collinear or not. Collinear additive category. Categories. A functor F between C and D is called K-linear. It's called additive or K-linear additive. If the category is also K-linear, if the maps so om C X Y om D F of X F of Y. So mapping F to F of F are additive or K-linear. Homomorphism, where X and Y in C. It's almost time. Let's state proposition before stop. proposition. There exists a natural isomorphism from f of x direct sum f of y to f of x direct sum y. Okay. So I will stop here for today. So we will stop here for today. See you on Saturday, same time. On Saturday. Because no session on Monday. Due to holidays. Okay, so see you on Saturday.